everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Lord, what a privilege it is to serve you. Just, Lord, to have that fellowship and that comfort and that peace that only you can give. And Lord, tonight we've just come to worship you, Father, to thank you, to lift your name high, and just to let you know, Father, how appreciative we are of all that you are doing and have done for us. And so tonight, Lord, as we worship you, Father, as we lift our hands and surrender and raise our voices in praise, receive it, Father, and may it be a blessing to you, Lord, as you have blessed us. We just thank you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, your kindness, your patience, Father. We are a blessed people above all the people of this earth. We are a blessed people. And Lord, we thank you for that this evening. So as we just start this service, Lord, just look into our hearts and may our words express what is there. As we just worship you, we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's kids that say, amen. Hey, let's remain standing.
Sing, come, Lord Jesus.
Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Holy Spirit, come.
Fall afresh on me. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. His deep cries out too deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
All who are thirsty, all who are
the fountain,
dip your heart in the streams of life, let the pain and the sorrow
be washed away in the waves of his mercy. His deep cries out to
Just the ladies, come, Lord Jesus. Rejoice over me while I am unaware. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me. You rejoice over me. You rejoice over me while I am unaware. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me. You paint the morning sky with miracles in my hope will always stand, for you hold me in your hand. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me. Lord, I'm amazed. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me. How wide, how deep, how great is your love for me. How wide, how deep, how wide. How deep,
just how deep,
how great,
Lord, how great
is your love for me. How wide, how wide. How great,
Lord, how great
is your love for me. Lord, I'm amazed. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me. Sing it out, church. Lord, I'm amazed. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you. How you love me. All right, you guys just sing it out. Lord, I'm amazed. Lord, I'm just to be with you, just to be with you. All I want, and all I want, all I need is just to be with you, just to be with you. Here I am at your feet, just to be with you, just to be with you. Lord, my life is an empty cup. Here's my heart, would you fill me up? I'm face to the ground, forsaking my pride, leaving my will, my burdens behind. All I want, all I want, all I need is just to be with you, just to be with you. Here I am at your feet, just to be with you, just to be with you. I have come to the end of me, and there's nothing I have to bring, but you said I belong. You say I am yours. Nothing compares to knowing you more. All I want, and all I want, all I need is just to be with you, just to be with you. Here I am at your feet, just to be with you, just to be with you. All I want, all I need is just to be with you, just to be with you. Here I am at your feet, just to be with you, just to be with you. You made a way for me, oh my Savior, I'm yours forevermore. You made a way for me, oh my Savior, I'm yours forevermore. You made a way for me, oh my Savior, I'm yours forevermore. You made a way for me, oh my Savior, I'm yours forevermore. And I'm yours forevermore. All I want, all I need is just to be with you, just to be with you. Here I am at your feet, just to be with you, just to be with you. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. Great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. Ooh, ooh, ooh. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sorrowful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him who pardoned me. To look on him who pardoned me. Ooh, 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 ooh. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my sorrowful soul and with his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. Ooh, ooh, ooh. With Christ my Savior and my God. Lord, we thank you that in Christ all things are possible, that we are a new creation. Lord, you have done the work of justification, Lord. Lord, allow us, Lord, within our hearts, continue the process of sanctification, being set apart from this world, Lord. Refine us, Lord. Burn away, God, all that is not holy. Be glorified, Lord. Purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. purify my heart. Let me be as gold, pure gold. Refiner's fire, my heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will. Purify my heart, cleanse me from within, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin, deep within. Refiner's fire, let's all stand. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will.
Refiner's fire.
Refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will, ready to do your will, ready to do your will.
You know, Lord, we're just a thankful bunch of people this evening. And I know that, you know, my heart just goes out, Father, tonight toward you. Because I know, Father, that you are the source of all joy and of all peace. And you know, Father, as I look around and I see that we're in troubling times, you know, things aren't well. They're not well politically. They're not well economically. Lord, they're not well spiritually. What a comfort it is tonight to look to you. And to know, Lord, that you have placed in me a fountain of living water that satisfies me in every season of the soul. That you will never leave me nor forsake me. Lord, that you are my provision and my hope. You're my confidence. You're the defender of my reputation. You're the lover. Lord, we just look to you tonight and we say, Father, thank you. What a kind Father you are. How how you give to us the things that we don't deserve. And oh, how often we come to you and we say, Father, again, I have failed you and I'm so sorry. And all we hear back from you is words of encouragement. Words like, you're my son, of course. You're my daughter, absolutely. It goes without saying that you're forgiven. Then, Lord, you give to us things that we absolutely don't deserve. And we know it, Father. And so it's to you we look again this evening, and we thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord, that we're your sons and we're your daughters and that you're our Father. We thank you, Jesus, that not only are you our Savior, but you're our Lord. Holy Spirit, we thank you for being that ever-present strength and encouragement in our life. We thank you for these things tonight from the bottom of our heart. And Lord, this is one of those nights where I don't even feel like I want to ask you for anything. I don't want to pray for any of the needs, Lord. You've been more than enough. We just want to thank you tonight for your goodness, the goodness of the Lord. And so we do so in Jesus' name. And all God's kids would say, amen, amen. Hey, listen, before the youth are dismissed, you can be seated. I want my son to stand up. He turned 20 years old on Monday. And so I no longer have a teenager living in my home, so I have a young man who's a little taller than I am. And he you know what I notice? He'll like to come up and stand alongside me every once in a while and kind of look like this. I know what he's doing. He doesn't think I get it. He's trying to compare, see if he's a couple inches taller. But Charity, my youngest daughter, his closest sibling, is seeing this as an opportunity to embarrass him. So if you'll roll the tape, we're going to walk down memory lane for a moment. And this is Micah when we first moved up here, as a matter of fact.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
You just can't pass up an opportunity to absolutely disrespect your children. So that was my opportunity. Okay, you guys can be dismissed. Pastor Aaron can deal with you guys. Hey, let's turn our Bibles again this evening to the book of John. We've come as far as chapter 4, and that's where we'll pick up this evening. John's Gospel, chapter 4. And as you're turning there, let's pray. Father, how we thank you again this evening for your word. How else would we know your heart and your character? How else will we know your mind and your will, except that you had given it to us, written down, for us to read and to digest and to understand? And Lord, as we come now to the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John, absolutely, I know I say this all the time, but my favorite chapter, it reveals your heart. And such an open and perfect way. How, Lord, you seek out the broken and the hurting. And how you bring health and healing to them. And you're not a respecter of persons. As we're going to see this woman at the well tonight, Lord, how you reached out to her and loved on her and brought her into the fold. God, may these things speak to our heart tonight of how much you care for us and the extent that you're willing to go, Father, to meet us where we're at and to minister to the needs that we have, no matter how great they are. So, Lord, just speak to our hearts tonight. Lord, not just our heads. We would ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, it's by no happen chance that we find chapter 3 and chapter 4. Of course, 3 and 4 go together. But these two narratives put together, you cannot have two opposite people Jesus ministering to, the Nicodemus and the woman at the well. You know, here we have Nicodemus, a very religious man, no doubt a very moral man. You know, a teacher of the law, one of the Sanhedrin, one of the 70 elite. He coming to Jesus by night kind of speaks maybe a little bit of a proud man, not wanting other people to know that he doesn't know all things, and he's still in the mode of inquiring about some stuff. And so he comes to Jesus by night, and Jesus just ministers to him where he's at. Explains to him the way of salvation, the need to be born again. Even though he's a religious man, even though he's a moral man, even though he's a teacher of the law, he still needed to be born again. He still needed that rebirth. He still needed that work of the Spirit in his heart. He still needed the blood of Christ to be applied to his life. And remarkably, in direct contrast, tonight before us is a woman whose life has come apart at the seams, no doubt. You know, we're going to see tonight she's been married 5 times. The man she's living with is not her husband. This is a woman who is absolutely disillusioned with life. I don't think as a young girl she grew up, you know, wishing and hoping that someday she would be divorced 5 times and just living in sin with a man that's not her husband. We're going to see through the narrative today that she comes to the well at noon. The tradition was that the young ladies would come in the morning. You see, they didn't have Facebook or cell phones then, so you gathered around the well. And that's how you caught up on things early in the morning. And then when they had left, she would come at noon and gather water. And I think every time she dropped a bucket into that well, we're going to find out it was a deep well. In fact, archaeologists tell us it is the deepest well in all of Palestine, Jacob's well. But as the bucket went down, she probably, no doubt, thought, how hollow is my life? How unfulfilling. Broken and filled with shame and disappointment. I don't think there's a better picture in all of God's word of Jesus' care and love for the broken than we have before us tonight. So let's just dive right in. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John. You know, they already were a little intimidated by John the Baptist's ministry. How the people were coming to him and repenting and making way for the Messiah. And now the Messiah comes on the scene, at least the one that John proclaimed to be the Messiah. They knew that. And now more disciples are gathering around Jesus, and he's baptizing more than John. Though Jesus himself baptized not one disciple, he left Judea and departed again unto Galilee. He's leaving Judea. Now he's headed back north again to minister there in Capernaum around the Sea of Galilee. And it's interesting the route that he takes, because this is not the normal route. You would have gone onto the east side of Jordan, and you would have traveled really along the bottom lands of the river and made your way north, averting going through Samaria, because listen, the Jews would not have anything to do with the Samaritans. When the 10 tribes of Israel, the 10 northern tribes, fell into sin, and God used the Assyrians to come down and to discipline them, and they led them away, which was the custom of the Assyrians, and they would displace those people and place them with other people. When they placed the people in that land, lions rose up and began to eat the people, and their crops began to fail. So the people cried out to the kings of Assyria and said, listen, we don't know how to worship the gods of this land, because we're being displeasing to the gods of this land, because gods in those days were local, and everyone had a god. There were no atheists. If you're an atheist, you were an idiot. And so they said, we don't know how to worship the gods of this land, so send back some of those priests that you've displaced from the Jews, and let them teach us how to serve the gods of this land. And so when they came back, they began to minister the Torah, and so now you have a half-breed, you have a Gentile that's kind of somewhat familiar with the Torah, or at least the five first books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, and they're kind of a half-breed, and the Jews would have nothing to do with the Samaritans. They were the lowlife of the day. They were the drug addicts and the prostitutes of the time. They were the scum of the earth. In fact, a Jew at this time would much rather have something to do with a Gentile than they would with a Samaritan. These are the outcast and the offscouring of the world. These are the people today that would be all tatted up and all pierced and all color of manner of hair, you know, living on the streets, that's far too often, you know, we step across the road to pass by. These are the broken and the hurting. And watch what Jesus says here. And he must needs go through Samaria. He had an appointment. He knew this lady. He knew her story. He knew her pain. He no doubt had heard her cry. He had witnessed her tears. Every day he experienced her shame. The Bible says we do not have a high priest who's not touched with our infirmities. He knew her. And I think that this story is before us tonight, that we might take note of it, that we would never be prejudiced toward broken and hurting people. It's one thing for Jesus to minister to a Pharisee, to a moral man, to a religious man, to a teacher of the law who comes to him by night, to a proud man. But it's a whole other thing for him to minister to a woman who's been a failure in life, as far as any standard of her day. A woman now that is filled with shame and brokenness. All of her aspirations are gone. She's not living in an illusion that someday is going to get better. She is disillusioned with life. She has given up on anything that she ever hoped for. Married 5 times and not one of those things worked out. And finally, she's just living with the guy. I've given up on the dream. And I find it interesting that the religious person sought Jesus out, but Jesus is seeking this woman out because he cares about her. And the thing that impresses me the most about what is before us tonight in John chapter 4 is how Jesus cares for the broken, how he cares for the misfit and the outcast, how he cares for sinners whose lives have come apart at the seam. And he will go out of his way to find them. I must needs go through Samaria. I've got an appointment, a divine appointment waiting for me there. And it says in verse 5, then coming to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now, we know something about this parcel of ground. We know that it was purchased in Genesis chapter 33 and given to Joseph by his father in chapter 48 of Genesis. We know something about it, but what we don't find in the Genesis record is ever there a well being dug there. But I think that well was dug by Jacob hundreds of years earlier. Because Jesus knew one day he would sit on the brim of that well, and a lady whose life had come apart would sit next to him. And for the first time and to the first person, he will look her in the eye and say, I am the Messiah. I am the hope, not only of Israel, but of all mankind. He never said that to Nicodemus. And many times he would call himself the Son of Man, or he would avoid the issue, but he will lean into this woman, I think with very tender words, and say, listen, what you need, I have, and I am he that has promised to come. And so this woman, as she got up that morning, probably didn't know she was on a collision course. Jesus was about to introduce himself into her life. And how many times I wonder, we get up wondering, you know, can I bear another day? How many people out there getting up tomorrow morning saying, I don't know how I'm going to go through another day. You know, my life is a wreck. This is not what I had anticipated my life being like. How am I going to make it through another day? The pain and the depression, the drugs that own me, the alcohol that consumes me, you know, the unlisted sex that never pleases me, the relationships that are always broken around me. How am I going to get through another day? I wonder how many people, you see, 38 years ago, that was me. I was the woman at the well. I'm familiar with this person. I understand her. Because 38 years ago, I sat in a parking lot on a dark, damp, cold night, crying out to God, saying, if there's a God in heaven, if you're real, make yourself known to me. And nothing, no writing in the sky, no angel knocking on the window. That was the darkest night of my life. And I left there concluding there is no God and there's nothing beyond what I'm experiencing right now. And this is too painful and I'm just going to go home and end my life. And before that night was over, you've heard my testimony many, many times. Before that night was over, Jesus interjected himself into my life. And he called an outcast to be his son. What a remarkable and incredible story. And then we read in verse 6, now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus therefore being wearied with his journey. You know, I find that incredible how the Holy Spirit just puts that in there. This is God taking on one of these, a human body. And we would think somewhat, because it's God in flesh, that he would be like a Superman. But Jesus grew weary like you and I grow weary. He was fatigued. The day was long. He probably knew he had a certain amount of time to get from Judea to Samaria because he knew at noon that lady would be there. Maybe he hurried to be there. He was exhausted when he got there. And you know what? The Bible says we don't have a high priest that cannot be touched with our infirmities. He's been tempted in every way. He's been tried. You know what? He knows what you and I are going through. Because he sensed it. He's felt it. He understands it. And Jesus being wearied there as he comes to the well. It's about the sixth hour. This is high noon in Jewish timekeeping. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. And again, she comes at noon. The custom would have been that she should have been there in the morning when it was the cool of the day to draw the water, to bring it to her family, to prepare the morning meal, to get ready for the lunch and the dinner. She would have come if she would have been a woman, you know, of somewhat of purity or renowned in that community. She would have come in the morning and then she would have hobnobbed with all the rest of the ladies. She would have caught up on whatever is going on. You know, I watch my wife over there and she's connecting with the ladies on Facebook. They didn't have Facebook. They didn't have cell phones. They had the well. and you come to the well, and that's where you catch up on things. And having come to the well, there by herself, she begins to draw water. Again, just another reminder of her empty life. And Jesus saith unto her, give me a drink. You know, I find it interesting how Jesus just interjects himself into her life. And I think it's noteworthy for you and I to find out how we should inject ourselves into other people's lives. You know, Jesus doesn't look at the woman. He knows what's in her. He knows what's about her. He knows her life inside and out. In a few moments, he's going to reveal some things about her that he already knows. You know, he doesn't call her a sinner. He doesn't say, man, your life is a mess. Look at this. You know, sometimes that's how we start conversations with sinners. Look at yourself, man. You're a mess. You know, get it together, dude. You can't keep living like that. Listen, Jesus died to save even someone like you. Somehow that's sometimes how we introduce a conversation. And Jesus just introduced himself in a very common way. Hey, you know, you're here drawing water. I don't have anything to draw with. How about giving me a drink? And watch her response. Because the disciples had gone into town to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria, you know, we don't even have her name here. I think that Jesus is just that gentle. Because he doesn't want to embarrass anybody. And, you know, her name is not recorded here. Just the woman of Samaria said unto him, how is it? Now, we're going to watch a progression here. Because I think there's a little, you know, kind of a sarcastic tone in her voice as she begins to interact with Jesus. Maybe she even senses that, hey, here's another guy just trying to pick up on me. You know, what's the deal? You know, I always seem to attract the losers. You know, here I am, I've come down here at noon to get away from everybody because I don't want to be reminded of my past. You know, I don't want the sneers and the jeers. I don't want the whispers, you know, behind my back. I come here at noon just to get away from that, to just get some water, to take it back to my home. And now I'm getting hit on by this guy. No, he's saying to me, you know, give me something to drink. And watch this. How is it that thou, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Yeah, what's up with this? You being a Jew. No doubt she could tell he was a Jew because of the blue border around his garment. Every righteous Jew wore one of those. She knew who he was. And no doubt she's thinking, well, this is something quite interesting. How is it you, being a Jew, would talk to somebody like me? A woman of Samaria. And get what Jesus says in verse 10. And Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith unto thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Two things. If you knew the gift, and if you knew the giver of the gift. You see, that's the problem with the world today, is it not? We don't know the gift and the giver of the gift. You know, we keep drinking at the same well over and over and over and over, thinking that it will satisfy. In a few moments, Jesus is going to say, you can drink at this well and continue to drink at this well, and you can drink at this well every day, and it will never satisfy you. But there is a gift. And a gift has nothing to do with the one who receives the gift of their worth. It all has to do with the one who wants to give the gift. If you knew the gift and the giver of that gift, you would ask of him and he would give you living water. Now there's an interesting play on words here in the Greek, because you have to understand that living water, as far as the Jews were concerned, was a gift from God. Running water. Water that came out of a fountain or water that came out of a spring. Because most of these wells were kind of like water that kind of, you know, flowed through the rocks and kind of came up into like a cistern kind of a situation. We would call it stagnant water or stale water. There were things growing in it, squiggly little things and green things and all kinds of things. You could scoop the water. You could tell water that came out of a cistern or a stagnant or stale well because there were squiggly wigglies in it. And that was the kind of water that was represented here. But what Jesus is talking about, I would give you living water. Living water is something that comes from a fountain that bubbles up. It's alive. It's flowing. It's pure. It's clean. It has no squiggly wigglies in it. You can hold it up in a glass and it's clear. What he's saying to her is you've been drinking from the stagnant and still water and you're finding out it's not satisfying. How many people drink from the stagnant and stale water of this world and they come to that well over and over? I did it for years. And I dipped into the drugs and the amoral sex and I dripped into all of those things and I found that that water was stagnant and it was stale and it had things in it that weren't fit to drink. And I drank and I drank and I would just come back the next day thirsty a time and time and time again. What Jesus is saying to this woman whose life has come apart, who's filled with broken dreams, guilt and shame, a pain probably so deep she can't even communicate it to anybody, thus she comes in the middle of the day when nobody comes to the well. And she dips out the stagnant and stale water. This time she finds a man sitting on the brim of the well when she comes and he asks for a drink. He's a Jewish man. And I think somewhat with some indignation, she looks at him and said, now this is an incredible thing. You being a Jew would even speak to me, a woman and a woman of Samaria. And then Jesus says to her, if you knew the gift, if you knew the gift that I'm willing to give and the giver of that gift, you would ask of him and he would give you living water, not this stale stuff, refreshing, pure water. And the woman saith unto him, sir. Now watch as she's progressing from, you know, this kind of like, you know, flippant, indignant kind of attitude toward Jesus being a Jew to sir, thou hast nothing to draw with. The well is deep. From whence then are they going to give me living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? Yes, he is. Jacob gave them a well that they had to come every day and drink from. They had to come to the well. They had to dip into that well. They had to drink from that well. And what they brought up out of that well was stagnant and stale. And it never satisfied because the next day you had to come back again. Whatever this world offers you is just that way. It never can satisfy. Are you greater than Jacob who gave us this well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? And Jesus said unto her, whosoever drinketh, and in the Greek that is to drink and to continue to drink of this water shall thirst again. It cannot satisfy. It will never satisfy. What an illusion to think that the things of this world could ever satisfy. You know, by their very nature, they are diminishing in their glitter and their gleam. You know, you think that you can't live with without the new model of car. You see it come out, man. It backs itself up, you know. It's got every button and gadget. You just say, call my wife and it calls your wife. You know, you say this radio station, it turns that radio. They have cars today that are just amazing. And you think you can't live without the new model until you finally get one. And you push the button for it to back itself up and it malfunctions and it runs into a car and it, you know, and all of a sudden your shiny new little penny, you know, is a hunking piece of crunched metal. Or if you don't do that and it just kind of goes on, pretty soon you find out that there's scratches and some inconsiderate person has opened their door into it, and pretty soon the weather stripping is weathered and it's lost its color. And you know, the next thing you know, none of the electronic stuff works, and you just realize this thing that I thought I could never live without is a piece of junk, and now I gotta go get the next or newer model. You see, that's the way life is. If you drink from the wells of this life. Whosoever drinketh of this water will thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But that water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto everlasting life. Not only will I give you water to drink, but listen, I'll give you a well, and I'll put that well in your heart, and that well will go with you wherever you go. You don't got to come to it. It will be in you. Pure water. Satisfying water. Crystal clear water. Refreshing water. Living water. Bubbling up in you. And the woman saith unto him, verse 15, Sir, give me this water, and that I thirst not, neither have to come here and draw water anymore. I won't have to come out of my home. I won't have to put myself in a situation where I can be embarrassed. I won't have to run into any of these ladies who are whispering and pointing at me any longer. You just give me that water and I'll just stay home. Yeah, I'll have some of that. And Jesus saith unto her, now watch how this conversation progresses. Go call your husband. Have him come here. And we can drink this water together. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus saith unto her, Thou hast well said, you have no husband. Here's the thing about the Lord. You cannot hide from him. Back in chapter 2, he said, no man needed to testify of men to Jesus because he knew what was in men. That exterior that you put up to hide the brokenness, that face that you put on to hide the shame and the guilt, the fake smile that you plant on your face to cover the pain, Jesus sees past all of it. And he sees you. The real you. The you that sometimes you're so afraid to share or to show to anybody else. Because you just know if somebody knew the real you, they wouldn't like you. They would be disgusted with you. They wouldn't want anything to do with you. And here's the beauty of it, guys. In a few moments, this woman's going to say, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Nothing is hidden from him. And yet this man offered me the gift of eternal life. This man spoke with me. This man cared about me. This man didn't reject me. He didn't whisper. He didn't point. This man sat tenderly beside me and ministered to the pain of my life. Go get your husband. I don't have one. You have well said you don't have one. Thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. Now you have spoken truly. And now the woman says, she's gone from, hey, you being a Jew, to sir, to I perceive you're a prophet. And notice how she evades and avoids this, you know, experience where God is just opening her heart. Now listen, what you need to note here is many times when you're witnessing to people and the Lord is stirring in their hearts, how many have had this experience? You know, you're right there and you know that it's getting really real and you're talking about real things and you're pushing a button that's really real in their life and the Lord is dealing with them and you can see the conviction come over their face and you can see the work of the Holy Spirit come over their body and you can just see as they tense up and now they want to talk about anything but the real. Man, the wall just springs up. And that's what happens here. The wall just springs up and she goes, our fathers worshipped in this mountain and you say that Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. She changes the subject. Let's talk about religion. I'm comfortable talking about religion, but let's don't talk about relationship. Let's don't talk about pain. Let's don't talk about my past. Let's don't talk about my failures. Let's don't talk about any real issues. I'm okay to talk about religion. So she changes the subject. And Jesus just kind of goes with it. He doesn't bring her back to her past. He doesn't bring her back to her failures. He's touched on it. And I think this is how Jesus does it. Because he knows there are things in our life that are so painful that you can't just give them all over at once. He touched on it. And he's going to let that settle in for a moment. She changes the subject and he flows with it. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. The Samaritans thought it was Gerizim. And of course, the Jews were right and they said it's Mount Zion. It's in Jerusalem, the proper place to worship. But Jesus is saying the day is coming, the hour is near. When he is crucified and he goes to be with his Father, and no longer will it be a location geographically, but he will live in each man and woman's heart that will invite him in there. The hour is coming. Neither in these places will it be right to worship. And verse 22 says, you worship what you know not. We worship what we know, for salvation is of the Jews. We know that we later will be grafted in when the Jews reject. But the Jews had it right. They had the right God. They had the right scriptures. They were looking for the Messiah, the right Messiah. But the hour cometh, verse 23, and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Not just in spirit, but in spirit and in truth. Get this, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. Who's seeking? You know, I've heard a lot in the last 10 years, and I don't quite understand it, to be very honest with you. I've had conversations with pastors of these kind of churches. They call them seeker-sensitive churches. And I don't understand the philosophy behind it, because I don't think God plays in hide-and-seek with anybody. Look at the text here. Jesus is going out of his way to interject himself into the life of this woman. This was a divine appointment. And I believe that every person born into this life will have that divine appointment. There's a day that God will interject himself into your life. Now, you can either accept it or reject it, but there will be that day. But this seeker-sensitive, I don't understand, because nowhere in the Bible does it talk about that. Listen, the Bible says we have not sought him. There are no seekers. But he has sought us. If there's a seeker-sensitive church, then it's that God is seeking you. He is seeking you constantly. He is calling you. The Holy Spirit is at work in this world, calling men into a relationship with the living God. He's the seeker. We are all like sheep that have gone astray. We're the runners, you see. We run. He seeks. And he keeps seeking until he finds you. The Bible says he's come to seek and to save that which is lost. So what we should be doing in churches is boldly proclaiming Jesus, the true seeker, and we should be finders. We should help people be finders, not seekers. You know, you don't have to seek any longer. When you come into the doors of this church, you should find Jesus here. A lover of men's souls. One who can restore the broken back to a place of sanity. Because that's what he does. Now watch what he says here. This is interesting. He says in verse 20, but the hour's come, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in the spirit of truth. For it is the Father that seeketh. And the ETH in the Old English means he seeks and he continues to seek such to worship him. Why does God seek you to worship him? Because he knows in his presence you will be blessed. He knows in his presence you will be protected. Father knows best. Because in his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures evermore. He knows that sin hurts and sin makes you stupid. And he knows that you have an enemy out there that wants to destroy your soul. And if you drink from those still waters, sooner or later, you're going to get the incurable disease that that water carries. And so he comes seeking. Just like he came to this woman in Samaria at the Jacob's well in Sychar. He came seeking her. Because he knew if she would give him her life, he would give her the gift of eternal life. And he would put in her a well that would so satisfy her, she would never thirst again. For God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. It's not about religion. It's about relationship. This is what he's communicating to this lady. It's not about religion. It's not about the geographical places, or it's not about the methods or the means. It's about a relationship with the living God. God has sent his son to die on a cross, is what he's communicating to her, that you might have the gift of eternal life from the giver of life, a well living in you, springing up in you that will so satisfy you. And the woman saith unto him, I know that when the Messiah comes. You see, they knew the first five books of the Bible. They knew the promises associated with the Messiah. When the Messiah comes, which is called the Christ, when he comes, he will tell us all of these things. Listen, I don't know who you are, bub. You're a Jew, I get that. You're probably a good guy, I get that. You're a prophet, I got to understand that. But when the Messiah comes, he's going to tell us all of these things. And verse 26, what an incredible verse. Picture it in your mind's eye. Jesus is sitting. We know from the scripture, he's sitting on the well. He was exhausted. He seated himself on the brim of the well. She comes to draw water. They're engaged in a conversation. And I think at this moment, she just sits down because, listen, she hasn't rejected him. He's having an honest conversation with her. She's intrigued. She's curious how this man knows all this stuff about her life. I think she sits down on the well beside him, and they're having a very intimate conversation. Listen, that's how Jesus will meet any one of you. That's how he met me. He'll just come and sit down alongside you. Talk about real things. And she says, listen, when the Messiah comes, which is called the Christ, he's going to tell us all of these things. And I think Jesus leaned over to her in a very tender way and said, sweetie, I that speak unto you am he. The Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God, God incarnate, is seated next to you. And I don't reject you. In fact, I've come a long journey to meet you right here where you're at. And I'm going to offer you a gift that if you'll take it from the giver of all good gifts, it will be a well inside of you springing up, so satisfying your soul, pure, crystal clear water, refreshing water. Now, watch this. And upon this came his disciples. Man, these guys, listen, they never seem to get it right. You know, come at the wrong time. And they marveled that he talked with the woman. What's he doing? He's talking to a woman. He's talking to a woman of Samaria. Jews don't talk to women. Then I think Jesus wanted to make the point that in the kingdom of heaven, there is no prejudice. Because God's not a respecter of persons. He didn't come for the healthy. He came for the sick. I qualified. And there are days I still qualify. Amen. And Jesus, because we've accepted him as our Savior, the Bible says he's not ashamed to be called our God. You know, he's not ashamed of you. And one of the things I see in this story, in this narrative, is that Jesus is not ashamed to associate with sinners, honest sinners. Sinners that are willing to be open and have an honest conversation with him. They marvel that he's in having this conversation with her. Yet no man said, "What seek thou?" or "Why talkest to her?" They didn't say it, but he knew what was in them. And get this, the woman then left her water pot. You know, it's interesting how the Holy Spirit puts this stuff in here. Man, this chapter is so rich with just application to our lives. You know why she left her water pot? She didn't leave it because it wasn't valuable. In those days, containers were valuable. They weren't like Tupperware today where if you get a little crack in it, you throw it away, or get a stain, you don't want to wash it, you toss it. Listen, that was a valuable instrument. It was a necessary instrument. She may have only had one, maybe two of those water pots. She left her water pot because she found water that would satisfy her forever. She didn't need, it's symbolistic, as she didn't need the water of the world anymore. Listen, when we go follow Jesus, we don't need the things of this world anymore. You can lay up. I remember the night I got saved coming down the hill, man, I rolled down my windows. Lucky I didn't get arrested, because out went stuff that if they would have seen me throwing it out and picked it up, I would be in jail probably till today. Because I didn't need my old water pot anymore. You see, because I wasn't coming back to that well again. I didn't need it. Jesus gave me a gift that has satisfied me for these 38 years. Oh, I had my friends say, "Oh, you'll be back. It's a fad. It'll wear out, dude. He got religion." I didn't get religion. I led many of my friends to Christ, to the same water. But I didn't need the stuff anymore, because I wasn't coming back. She left her water pot, watch this, and went her way into the city and saith unto the men, "Come see a man which told me all things I ever did. Is this not the Christ?" Now, I probably freaked some of those guys out. "What do you mean he told you everything that you ever did?" Listen, my wife's over here. Listen, "What do you mean he told you everything?" Because they knew this woman. "Is this not the Christ?" Then they went out of the city and came to him. And in the means while his disciples prayed with him, saying, "Master, eat." But he said to them, "I have meat to eat that you know not of." Listen, again, this is another beautiful picture, because listen, there's something about doing the will of the Father that is more satisfying than anything. What Jesus hungered for, and get this, what you and I ought to be hungering for, is to do the will of the Father. I find no greater pleasure or satisfaction or contentment than when I am doing the will of the Father. Jesus said, listen, they brought back food and they're having this conversation between themselves. "Well, give him something to eat." Well, he says, "He doesn't want anything to eat." "Well, why doesn't he want anything?" He said, "Well, he has meat that we know not of." Did somebody slip him something? Therefore said his disciples one to another, "Hath any man brought him anything to eat?" And Jesus said to them, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Say not yet, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest." You see, I think that here's the deal. As we're winding this thing down tonight, we're only going to go through verse 41. Some of you are looking, "Man, there's a lot of verses to go, and his time is up. How is he going to get through the whole?" Well, I didn't plan on doing the whole chapter. You eat a steak one bite at a time. And this is a good steak. Jesus is reminding us here that we have a limited amount of time to reach hurting people. And I think he's example to us in a very beautiful way that his heart is for the broken. His heart is for the outcast. That he would go out of his way to sit next to a woman whose life has come apart at the seams. give her a gift. To even be willing to be associated with sinners and maybe even be ridiculed for that. And sometimes we can get so busy in this life, with this life, that we don't slow down long enough to consider what is the most important thing about this life. If you've been given the greatest gift that could ever be given a man, eternal life, and if that well is springing up in you and it's so satisfied you, if you've been a recipient of his grace and of his mercy, if you've been one, like Humpty Dumpty, he's put your life back together again. And you know his love and his compassion. How can we say, well, I don't have time today. It's not harvest time yet. I'll get around to it later. I'll call my aunt or uncle next week or next month, you know, or maybe the next family reunion. Why isn't there a sense of urgency? Because I think there was a sense of urgency in Jesus when he said, I must needs go through Samaria. There's a woman that's going to be sitting in a well whose life is broken, that doesn't know if she can get through another day. And I need to go give her hope. I need to go give her life. I need to go reveal myself to her. Woman, the one you speak to is the Messiah. And here Jesus says, say not, yet there are 4 months, and then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes. And here's the beautiful thing. As these guys were coming, they would have been dressed in white, and it would have looked like the fields. This is what he's saying. Look up now at the fields. They are white already to harvest, and he that reapeth receiveth the wages and gather fruit unto eternal life, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth shall rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, one soweth and another reaps. You don't know. Somebody might have already been sowing the seeds at your work, witnessing to somebody, and you come along and you water that. And maybe somebody else comes along and they're just at the right place and saying, you know what, I'm ready. I'm ready. You know, I remember our first trip to Africa. I thought this was really strange. A guy actually ran me down. He saw a Bible in my hand, saw that I was white. Obviously, I must have stood out. I'm walking in a crowd of Africans on the way down to the church to teach the pastors that afternoon. And as I'm walking down there, this guy comes bolting, running toward me. And he says, in English, good English, you have a Bible. And I said, that's right. He said, listen, somebody told me that God loves me and that God could forgive me. And if I can see it in print, I'll believe it. But I don't know anybody that has a Bible. Could you show that to me? And I just walked him through Romans Road. And when he looked and read, the tears welled up in his eyes and he fell on his feet. And he said, today I believe it. I receive you. I'm walking to the church. You talk about fish jumping in the boat. I couldn't believe it. Somebody had been witnessing to that man and he was primed and ready. But he wanted to see it in the Word of God for himself. You don't know how the Spirit has been working on people around you. I offer for your consideration tomorrow, you might wake up by saying, Lord, who would you have me speak to? What broken person that puts the fake smile on their face and props themselves and puts themselves together to face another day is my life going to be interjected into? And may you give me the boldness and the words to tell them, there's hope in Jesus, the giver of life. Don't say today, tomorrow. Today is the day. And then he says this, and I send you to reap where you have not bestowed any labor. Other men have labored, and you have entered into their labors. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the sayings of the woman which testified, He told me all things I ever did. And so when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode there for 2 days. He stayed in that city of Sychar, and for 2 days he taught them. And get this, and it says in verse 41, and many more believed because of his own word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. One of the most beautiful stories in the Bible, as far as I'm concerned. And we have it set in this remarkable contrast where you have this religious man in chapter 3 coming to Jesus, a moral man, a teacher of the law, one who sat in the prestigious place of a ruler of Israel. He sat in the Sanhedrin. And he comes and asks Jesus, how do you go to heaven? And Jesus tells him, you must be born again. Being moral religious won't get you there. And we can understand that. We can wrap our hands around that. But the very next person that the Bible introduces to us in this gospel is this woman, a Samaritan woman, 5 times divorced, living in sin, broken and filled with shame. And Jesus says, I need to go and be with her. Because this is the last day that she's going to drink from the still waters of this world. Today, she's going to get a new well, and she won't need her old water pots anymore. And I'm not ashamed to sit next to her and tell her I'm the Messiah. Because I've come to seek and to save that which is lost. God is not a respecter of persons. And I think this stands out as a lesson to the church that neither should we be. I delight my heart if God would fill this church with all different colored hairs. I'm not talking about just gray and blue. But I mean, and people tatted and pierced it. Because you know what? Those people are disillusioned and they're broken. And Jesus loves them. And he has a gift that he wants to give them. And he can make them all new. Just like he did for you and me. Both the most religious, moral person on the planet and the worst of sinners needs the blood of Jesus, needs the gift of his grace. They both need him, and they come to him on a level playing field. Both of them need Jesus, and Jesus is willing to give himself to both of them. Amen. And our part in this is to see, as we pass through this life, not so hurriedly, but to see the broken people. You know, when Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25, when he came to separate the sheep from the goats, he's going to say to those on his right hand, when I was in prison, you visited me. When I was sick and hungry, you fed me, you took care of me. When I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. And they're going to say, when did we do that? When did we see you unclothed and clothe you? When did we see you hungry and feed you? When were you thirsty and we gave you to drink? And Jesus will say unto them, when you did it to the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. When you did it to the least, you did it to me. God's heart breaks for the prostitute out there selling her body every day to try to make ends meet. His heart breaks for those people sitting on death row or in prison somewhere because they made bad decisions and they're filled with guilt and shame and remorse. God cares about them. He cares about the drug addict that just can't seem to get rid of the habit, that thinks that the well that he's drinking from will satisfy, and he finds that it doesn't. He will sell his soul to get the next fix. God cares about him as well as he cares about the moral and religious man. Both of them need the gift that Jesus has to offer. And we need to be instruments in his hand bringing that gift. Would you not agree with me? And we need to slow down and pay attention. Because tomorrow, Jesus might want to interject himself into somebody's life, and you might be the instrument that he wants to use. Amen? Let's stand. I've used up the worship time, so we'll just pray. Father, again, this portion of Scripture, it moves me. Moves me deeply. Because in it, I find your heart. In it, Lord, I see your passion and compassion. And Father, may that same heart be our heart. May that same compassion be our compassion. Who art thou, O man, who judges another man's servant? God, help us to get rid of those prejudices. And just love people like you loved them. And be willing, Father, to go sit next to them and have an honest conversation with them. And bring them to the Messiah. Help us to be those people, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name. And all God's kids would say, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, a very sweet sound in your ears. Father, help us. Help us even tomorrow. You know, as we get up and, you know, life just takes on what it takes on, Lord, as we're going through the day, to be cognizant, to be aware of, to be in tune with our surroundings. And, Lord, to be looking for and have a sense of a divine appointment that you, Father, may want to design for us, that, Lord, you might be interjected into somebody's broken life. Help us to be your hand extended, Lord. Help us to be your representative of hope and grace and mercy and forgiveness. Use us, Father, we pray. Make us like you, Jesus. With hearts filled with compassion. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's kids would say, amen. 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 Hey, if you need prayer, we'll be up here to pray for you. Other than that, listen, we've got cake in the back that has Micah's name on it, and you can eat as much as you want of that cake. If you're on the red team, you can have two slices.